chosen to test this station's destructive power on your home planet of Order.
What?
Then name the system. Order.
Loki religions and ancient weapons are no match for a good blast torch. I'm coming up on Alderaan.
You may fire when ready.
Welcome to Alderaan Explosion. Explosion Network's official countdown to Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker. It's 54 days until release. My name is Dylan Blight, your Jedi Master, and joining me, my Padawans, Ashley Hobley.
Hey Dylan, excited to be here to talk about the best droid in Star Wars movies, K2SO.
Debatable. And Kieran Marchant.
Hey Dylan and Ashley, I'm here to talk to you about Save It Private Ryan of the Star Wars universe.
That's the one. I'd like to bring it back.
Who is Private Ryan in your mind in this analogy?
Galen Erso.
No. Private Ryan is the USB stick with the Death Star plans.
Got him. It's more like a floppy drive, really.
You're taking it home, so it's because its previous three brothers died in war as well?
Yep. Ashley, you're reading too far into the analogy, my friend.
Okay. In case you didn't know, this week's episode we are discussing the first Star Wars story, the first Star Wars spin-off movie, Rogue One. I want to bring it back to Ash's thing before, because how much did you laugh when I replied to your tweet about him being the best thing, and I found that Rebels clip of someone with Chopper from Rebels the Animated Series, and Chopper's like, what the fuck? And then someone like put this... the fucking font over it, which Chopper says, what the fuck? Chopper's a better droid than...
I did specifically say movies.
Okay. I'm going to get all...
Pedantic
about it. Just be careful what you're doing.
Because we all know droid from the Old Republic is the best one. Anyway, move on.
All right, it's not canon, so you can't count that. When was the...
Yes, it is.
So, as always, when was the last time you watched Rogue One? And now, upon this rewatch, how do you... feel about it at the moment? Kieran, let's start with you.
I can't remember the last time I watched Rogue One. I've watched it a couple times since it was released, at least three or four times, but I can't remember exactly when that was, so maybe 1 to 2 years ago, possibly. And I love this movie. Like, I really like this. Is one of my favorite Star Wars movies. So yeah, I like it as much as I loved it then. Nothing's changed.
Hot diggity damn. Ash.
Yeah, I don't think I'd seen it since we probably watched it for the last time we did these. Still great movie, still really enjoyed it, still probably one of the best looking Star Wars movies, I'd say.
Oh, it's so good.
I think it's top two, easily.
Oh, just giving away.
Wait, top two on visuals, you're saying though? Or top two overall?
Okay. No, top two for visuals.
Yeah.
What else are you putting up there then?
I think the cinematography in this is like top notch. It's probably the best. Up with again, what? Top two and like world design and that kind of thing.
It is. Last Jedi.
With,
yeah, the, like, it's those two.
Last Jedi cinematography was fucking amazing. Like, I will die on that hill when people argue with Last Jedi.
Yeah.
Like, Rogue One. Not even getting into that yet. No.
Rogue One just. It just worked perfectly. It did the job that it was meant to do. Fill in this perfect gap and explain why they were able to blow up the Death Star with just one small vent.
It wasn't just a coincidence
that it was there.
It made a good movie out of a single crawl better than Solo. Like, it was better than Solo, and all it had was that crawl. Like, in the paragraph...
What paragraph did Solo come from?
Solo didn't come from anything. I don't know. I don't know where those comparisons came from. I just wanted to take it. I guess it Solo.
It came from that single line about the Kessel Run. That's the whole reason.
Yeah, something about the Kessel Run. Yeah. It's from all the Han Solo lore and all the Han Solo parts in movies we've seen. How he got his name, because we all, as we discussed, we all asked that question. We were like, how did he get his name? But yeah, this
the same way they named the ship in this movie. Yeah.
So I hadn't watched it since 2017 for the first run. Ooh. Of this podcast. Mm-hmm. First run of Old One. But also it is the Star Wars movie out of like any of Last Jedi, Force Awakens, Solo is the one I watched the fastest out of the cinema. Like, looking at my tract, I believe it's like December 15th, 2016, 0016 is when I checked in. So obviously the midnight release there. And then the next one, December 15th, 1400. So
2 o'clock the same day.
As far as what I remember is watching the midnight release, going to, getting home, going to bed. No, going home, recording a YouTube video, talking about how much I love the movie. And it was like 3 a.m., 4 a.m. by the time I got done doing that. And then I went to bed and then I woke up at whatever time. And as soon as I rolled over, grabbed my phone, I was like thinking about the movie straight away. I'm like, oh, that was such a good movie. I just pulled out my phone. I'm like, because I had the day off work. I just opened up the starting times and there was another screening starting in like an hour. So I just like, all right, I'm off. I'm off to see it away. So that's the fastest out of any of the movies I have seen. So yeah, I quite enjoy this movie. Loved it. Loved it from the moment it came out. And every time I watch it, I still really, really enjoy watching it. And I think as my notes will kind of pertain, I think rewatches now are just me picking up small little details that I'm becoming better at appreciating to do with like character stuff and like how well they've kind of like a lot of what may seem like tropey kind of characters are actually subverted, which I kind of wrote down in my notes here, which I enjoyed.
Make 10 men feel like 100.
We'll take the next chance. And the next. You're all rebels, aren't you?
Save the rebellion! Save the dream!
First thing I wrote down is blue milk. What a crazy thing that is. If not only for Ash mentioning on whatever prequel movie it was, but I was like, wasn't that blue milk in the thing?
I mean, there was blue milk in Solo as well. Yeah, when they're in the, they were talking to Lando for the first time, just saying. Didn't mention it then, but yeah, blue milk then.
Oh, okay, so it ripped out. The next thing I wrote down is Krennic is a fuck and I love him for it.
I tell you what, this role revitalized Ben Mendelsohn's career, really.
And now he's playing. He's the exact played that same role character.
Four times since. Effectively,
I literally watched. I randomly watched that new Robin Hood film.
Yes, he plays the same
Ciaran, and he plays the same character when he's playing the sheriff for not a good minute. I'm like,
yep.
Oh, you found your niche. Okay, fair enough, buddy.
Yeah, and then he played the same role in Ready Player One.
Yep,
and then we all thought he was going to play the same role in Captain Marvel.
He did to a point, I guess, without going into spoilers, but yeah, he's basically been playing the same. Especially Ready Player One is just, but none of those were as good as this because this character is written better, and it was the first time. And
I feel like you're biased.
I feel like
because you've
biased.
I remember you read some book setting it prequel book before Rogue One.
Yeah, which I didn't write down my notes because obviously we talked about it last time, but. It's impossible for me not to watch this movie. And as I just said, this is my fifth time total watching it, I guess. Five times watching this, and every single time the movie starts, I've never once watched this movie without knowing what the fuck is happening. Which has always been my thing, because I remember reading reviews and people being like, the movie starts so weird, and like, who are these characters? And you know, people are running around, blah, 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 blah. And I always found it so odd because, yeah, you read that prequel novel, Rogue One Catalyst, I think, is the book, which introduces you to Galen, Lyra, their daughter, like when they're working for their empire, and the book ends with them running away, going to hide on a planet. So then, of course, I read that book, and I'm sitting in theater in midnight release, the ship's flying in, you see Jin running along. I'm like, oh, like here comes Krennic to come get them back. You know, like it really felt like watching the sequel to something, really, because you hadn't read the book. So, but, you know, when it comes to Krennic and Ben Mendelsohn, I just feel like every other time he does this sort of role, Ready Player One or whatever, maybe it is because this is the first time, like, this is like the template.
Yeah.
So the rest of those times feel just like copycat performances.
Yeah.
And obviously he's been directed. Maybe they're not using the exact words, act like you did in Rogue One, but like, no, he's been directed to fill that role. yeah, it's a casting choice for sure, but it's like it, none of those ever feel as good as he does in this role, because this is obviously the original, you know?
Yeah.
But how many different ways can you act? You are a conniving uniform wearing man.
I guess he's just been typecast a lot since this movie. Like, even since last time we discussed it, I think he's just been typecast a lot for this role.
Yeah, and I feel like he brings Captain a lot Marvel to this role. And I haven't seen. He's got a couple of other Australian movies coming out this year, so
I hope they're different. Yeah, no, it's just more the Hollywood-y type stuff. And even like when I went in to see this, I already knew who Ben Mollison was because I was a big fan of Animal Kingdom. Yes. Like, I was big fan of that movie. So I was going in like, Ben Mollison, this is going to be great. I'd seen him in other stuff, but Animal Kingdom's like what my mind would go to when I thought about Ben Mollison. And Ben Mollison in Animal Kingdom is nothing like he is in this. More so how he is in this is more, I guess, in the direction of like him in Dark Knight Rises, I guess. Yes. And that's kind of like what more general audiences would probably remember him from. Because in case you don't know, if you got to like kind of tickle your memory brains over here, if you don't remember, in Dark Knight Rises, he's one of like the schemey dudes that like Bane financial people that Bane is dealing with, and he's kind of playing a twerp as well. He's not playing a leader type because, of course, Bane like kind of death stares him and he pees his pants. Well, he doesn't really, but like
probably does.
He probably does. Yeah, let's be honest. Yeah, so he's really good though, and he does bring a lot to the role. And I think, and I kind of discuss it. I think I bring it up here at some point, but I might as well just bring it up now. Like last week, where I was talking about reading these Fromm books. In the most recent Fromm book, they have Krennic in it quite a lot, because it's the most recent Fromm books. Basically, like, long story short, Fromm's whole thing is he's trying to come up with new versions of TIE fighters called TIE Defenders, and he wants money for that project. And they're basically TIE fighters that have like shields and stuff. Crazy concept, right? who'd have thought? So he wants money for that. And then, of course, Krennic wants money for Operation Stardust, which is the Death Star. Now, Tarkin wants the Death Star project. That's the whole thing with Tarkin. They've added in extended universe materials like his book and other books, even the Catalyst novel. Goes into how like Tarkin is over here sort of involved with the Death Star, because that's introduced even in episode 3, of course, with Vader looking at like they have that sort of dodgy CGI Tarkin in Revenge of the Sith, but it doesn't look that bad because, of course, he walks off before the camera gets like too close to him. But like Tarkin's always been like, I want the Death Star project. And in that book, it's all about having like Krennic. Tarkin's basically trying to make Krennic fight and Thrawn and all this sort of stuff. But the way they write, you can tell a character has been set by an actor, you know, like, and Ben Mendelsohn makes that character, when the way that character has been written and portrayed in the audiobook and everything is someone's just trying to do a Ben Mendelsohn thing, you know? Like, and that's because there is no way else you can write or perform the role of Krennic, because Krennic is in this one movie. As much as people will like may not think he's as big as like a Darth Vader or something, like an epic character, he is a character set in stone because Ben Mollison does play Krennic so well.
It's like if you have, I had something similar for another series that I was listening to on Audible, and it was a series that I had read growing up as a kid and I fucking loved it, and I had my own very ideas or like, you know, voices that I would hear when I read the book. And I found it so jarring while listening to the audio podcast, where the narrator would do such a fucking weird version of a set of characters' voices that would just like, I would find completely just jarring to a point where it would almost stop me from listening to the book. Once there is a set idea of what a character is, I think it's really hard for people to try and reinvent it or to change it. It would be weird to try and make something different of it once he's set kind of like the goalposts for what Krennic is.
Yeah. I think in one movie, I think it's like kind of step, like a triumphant thing to like kind of make a character that known to your audience's mind after one performance, you know? So I think that's quite impressive. And it just comes from all the things, because we've seen Tarkins and whatever else more like proper politician-y type things. But then in comes a dude wearing a giant white cape who's like, it's my project, you know, like he has a bit more and he definitely stands out amongst the ranks of what you're used to seeing as far as like emperor, imperial type workers and stuff. So, yeah. Next thing I wrote down is, I hope the Cassian show is kind of like his first scene. Lots of spy stuff, shows how bad the rebellion is at times. And then I want to talk about what we want out of the Cassian Andor Disney Plus show, which they have announced, and I think they're supposed to start shooting either towards end of this year or like early next year or something like that.
Yeah.
We don't know anything about it. We know that K2 and Cassian are going to be in it. We don't know exactly where it's going to be set. Now, before you're like, oh, it's going to be how they meet, that story has been covered in the comic. Not to say they couldn't redo it for live action, of course, but they've explained that story. So I don't know if that's the road they want to go down because it's not very interesting. But would you be excited for, are you excited for a Cassian Andor story? Maybe that's what it's going to be called. Cassian Andor series, Ash, and what would you like to see out of it?
Yeah, I'm keen for this. One, Diego Luna doesn't seem like he's going to age anytime soon, so he can play that probably character for a while before the events of this film. But I think what I want is him to be the bushy-eyed, bright-eyed guy joining the rebellion at the start and then working as a spy, slowly taking pieces of his soul.
Soul away?
Yeah. Okay. That's what I want to see. Which is kind of messed up, but yes.
Yeah, I know what you're saying, though. Yeah, and I'm like trying to work out like how far would they set that, whatever. And they may not only have to set that like 2 years prior to this, you know, like there's no reason to say he's been the fucked up spy he's been for so long. Like he could have just been the last couple of years and he could have, you know what I mean? Like you don't need to say he's been doing this since he was like 15, like fucking shooting people, like innocent people, like he does at Stars movie. But I definitely want the TV series focused on him to definitely feel like more like this first opening scene where you see him literally kill an innocent person.
He's informant, yeah.
Yeah, he's informant. Like, and that's something we never saw. That's one of the things that's so good about this movie. It's like it shows you things that make you go, okay, they are the good guys, but the good guys also have people doing bad things, you know? So I hope that's what that show dives into. Kieran, would you be excited? Are you going to be excited for that one?
I'd be excited for it as long as it continues to do what this movie does, which is bring a gritty realism to the Star Wars world. Because I think even in Star Wars in general, Star Wars as a general franchise is very almost clinical and very clean in many ways. There's not much about the human struggle or the actual, like, the fucked up shit that people had to do for rebellions and stuff. So I would want to see that. I want to see the darker side of the Star Wars universe. Not talking about the dark side, but like that, the other side of the coin. We've got
movies about that.
Yeah, we've got movies about that. I want to see that, the other side of the coin of what are the things that the rebels had to do in the name of good to take down the Empire.
Do we actually want it to be like a proper spy thing? And by that I mean like, because in this he talks about being a spy, but he's obviously,
I don't want James Bond.
No, but like, do you want to see him actually like go undercover somewhere for like a long period of time or something?
Not for a long period, maybe like an episode or something. But
I'd like for him to maybe have like an arc in like where he's like in a city or a certain place and he's got a target or an objective he has to, you know, achieve, and just his stories of what lengths he has to go to achieve them, or maybe following one person to various places around the galaxy. Could be a possibility.
Yeah, the other interesting thing when like speculating about any of these Disney Plus shows is because we haven't watched one yet, we don't know like how exactly they're going to feel. Like, is from what we can kind of gather about The Mandalorian, it definitely feels like it's kind of just going to be like one, you know, long movie story, you know what I mean? Like one long story. And obviously I think that's what Obi-Wan's going to be as well. But then it's like, is that kind of the standard then? Is the standard for Disney Plus Star Wars shows going to be, they basically are 6 to 10 hour long movies just in a TV series? Or could something like the Cassian series, would that be better suited to, like, here's a 3-episode arc and then let's go ahead like 6 months and here's another 3 to 4 episode arc. You know what I'm saying? Like, do they all need to be the same, like really long movies, or play around with different types? Like, what do you think would work better for a Cassian thing? Long movie or arcs? Like,
I think arcs would work better. Because I don't see, I don't believe, it depends on where the starting point is for his character. If he is the, as Ash suggested, the bushy-eyed kid that wants to help the rebellion, and it's about how he turns into this hardened spy that is ready to do the darker things to get the job done, I think that would take longer arcs to get through. That wouldn't just happen in one story. But if it's about like a midpoint of his existence as a spy, then it would be fine as one story.
Yeah. Because it's like when he kills that dude here, like his informant, he does it no fucks given. And you don't just get to that stage, you know? Like, there definitely has to be a moment in his life where he has to make some decision like that, and it's a struggle. But I guess once he crosses that line from that moment on, it becomes a lot easier for him to do, you know? All right, so back to the notes here. I wonder how general moviegoers will react to Saw in Jedi Fallen Order, and if we'll see any other notable characters like Two Tubes in that game. So how are we feeling about, a couple episodes later in this season, we're hopefully going to have time to discuss somewhat the game in one of the, between some episodes, but how are we feeling about Jedi Fallen Order, and in particular, like having a character like Saw show up? Because audience reaction to him, I think in this movie, was kind of like, meh. Like, I would say like no one particularly loved him. I quite enjoy seeing him in this because obviously he was a character from Clone Wars, and I thought it was really cool that they were doing that like connective fabric of bringing an animated character to live action. But then they also did really cool things in, like, when Rogue One was I think when Rebels returned, like it was on a mid-season break when Rogue One came out. So when like that, when Rebels came back in like January, the next couple episode arc of Rebels had Saw in it, but it was obviously years before Rogue One takes place, which like meant he wasn't as batshit crazy, and he like his body wasn't quite as bad and messed up and reliant on the machine that he has in Rogue One. So I kind of like how they kept playing with different periods of how crazy Saw gets, and I think that's what makes him an interesting character, because he goes from being like a, I'm on board with the rebels, to a like, yous aren't being, like he goes from that to, no, we'll just bomb cities and we'll fight, like the full-on like crazy stuff that he ends up doing in this movie, of course. But yeah, are you looking forward to seeing him in the game? Do you think that's going to be a thing that works well for people, Ash?
As long as it works for the story, I don't care either way. I mean, it's cool that he's being included, but as long as he's it works within the story of Fallen Order, I'll be happy to have him there if it works.
Care?
I think the problem with Saul in this movie was that this is probably the majority of Star Wars fans' first interaction with him, and the version we got was the batshit crazy one. And I think that's really hard to get. And it wasn't even like a likable batshit crazy. Like, sometimes you can get characters that are batshit crazy, but you'll like them. And I don't think he's supposed to be a likable batshit crazy character.
No, I don't think he's supposed to be likable.
No,
I think
he's not. He's supposed to be that gritty, tough, kind of really fucked up person who's been through some shit. But I think that was so hard for some people to kind of accept in a Star Wars movie and get across. I'm excited to see him. I like seeing him in other forms where he is his earlier self. He is a lot different character. And I think it would have been more interesting for people if they'd seen a different version of him first and then this version, to get like the kind of contrasts.
You get no contrast, because you're introduced to him at the start of the movie, of course, when he like saves Jin, but you don't get to like hear him talk or like see what he was like when he was with young Jin. Automatically we skip ahead in time, and next time you see him, his hair's a bit different or whatever else, and he's batshit crazy.
Yeah, exactly.
I think with the game, I'm going to be intrigued how people react though, because I just felt like he was a, when he came out, people had different opinions of him, and then We'll see how it goes. I'm enjoying that he's in it because I think he's an interesting character. What kind of like how I was talking about with the Solo episode, I kind of like seeing different factions within like the rebellion and how they all work. A part of the Rebel Alliance. Well, in Saw's case, not a part of the Rebel Alliance because he's so batshit crazy that they kicked him out. Yeah. All right, so back to the notes over here. Mentioned Thrawn. Okay, that's my... No, we can skip that one. That was my note about the Thrawn stuff, which we basically went over before. Next thing I wrote down was, are you kidding me? I'm blind. Mm-hmm. Which, as many times as I've watched this movie, it still makes me laugh. And I think it's just Donnie Yen's delivery of that, like as the bag's been putting over these, he's just like, are you kidding me? I'm blind. It's so funny. Yeah.
Give me a Chirrut and Baez series, miniseries.
Oh, they're like, I for me, would watch those, the fuck two, out of that. Those two are almost as interesting for me as companions as Chewie and Han. Like, they're on that same level for me of, I fucking love this relationship and their friendship, and I want to see more. Like, it sucks that they're only in this one movie.
Yeah, I'd love to see more of them. They work so well together. They have lots of charisma, obviously. Well, I think it mostly comes from Donnie Yen, to be honest. Like, he's the kind of, like, the leading factor of this. But and then also just within, like, the Star Wars universe, introducing, like, a character that's not a Jedi, but like is one with the Force, and you know, like it's obviously just a really unique character from that front, and kind of expands what Force users can be, because obviously most people think like Force users are just Jedi. It's like what's that? But then you've got these people over here. So next thing I wrote down is that escape scene and the Death Star is full of emotion. I remember. That's another thing that I don't kind of get sick of watching is their escape from Jeddah and just seeing that planet exploding and everything that's happening there. I really think I just love this way this scene is put together, because of course you know the Death Star is destructive. We've all seen A New Hope. We know it can blow up fucking planets. But I think there's just something about this scene and just seeing the slow, drawn-out, destructive ability of it and actually seeing people have to escape that from a planet front. And then the way the scene just plays out reminds me of like a Roland Emmerich, like end-of-the-world type escape scene, you know, like 2001 or like some shit like that where they're
explosions. This is the first time we've seen it like from the planet. Every other time we've seen it in a movie, we've seen it from...
Yes.
A distance.
You know, this is the first time that the destruction of the Death Star is humanized in any way. Like, before that, it's sci-fi, it's a little plastic planet being blown up to smithereens in a practical effect that you can't tell that there's people there. They'll tell you, oh yeah, there's people there, but your brain and your emotions do not register that until... you watch these people go through this shit. And this is that grittiness to this movie that I think really puts it, you know, that steps it out from the other Star Wars movies.
But even in Force Awakens, they showed it from a distance. They didn't show, like,
they cut to the one shot of the people looking out on the balcony. And then,
but that's it. They didn't.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So this one definitely hit harder, I think.
Yes, I think so.
Even if it was so less damage, technically.
Yeah. And it's just so haunting too, because when you see like that, the Death Star kind of just roll over to above Jeddah. Like, I just love the way everything. This movie is like, as you were saying before, like one of the best shot movies. But also, they use their special effects so well. Like within,
it has a sense of scale that I don't think many of the other Star Wars movies get right. The image of the battle cruiser over the top of the of the city, is like I think for many people that's the first time you get a true sense of how fucking big one of these ships is.
Yeah. They're always just up in space, which is hard to get a sense of scale because your mind
they're only up against other spaceships.
Yeah, and you're like, how do I bring that down to like a real world relatable scale?
And even like, you know, oh, but you've seen ships in like Coruscant, and I'm like, yeah, but Coruscant isn't like, there's no sense of size to Coruscant because it's a fucking giant city. Like, you to actually see that city and then just to have that looming vessel over the top of it is fucking, it was just, it's really, really nice to see.
Also, from an engineering point, I'd be interested to see how they kept that like hovering above the city for so long.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I don't know.
Just burning yeah, through this fuel.
I definitely feel like Rogue One just has lots of imagery that we hadn't seen in any movies before and we haven't seen since. Be that the destroyer looming above the city or like the way it shoots the Death Star coming in, it just makes it really feel like this actual Death Star, you know, like truly scary fucking thing that just, if you see that thing float above your planet, it's like, fuck my life.
Yeah.
It makes it scary for once. And I think this comes down to, like, in A New Hope, when Alderaan's destroyed, Leia, the way they've kind of retconned it and they've explained this in like, they did a Leia comic book that's basically about her trying to track down the remaining Alderaanian people. And I really enjoyed that comic because it has a whole thing where those people are like, why aren't you more upset? Like, why haven't you been crying? Like, they're doing that whole thing of being like, Leia, you should be more upset. Why aren't you as upset about the destruction of a planet as we all are? And they kind of force that on her. And it comes down to her being like, well, I wasn't allowed to be upset in the moment. You know, I had to be strong and so on and so forth. I don't think they were thinking about that when they made the movie originally.
No, but they can go back and fix it.
Yeah, in like retconny type canon stuff, whenever we watch A New Hope now, which we will be next week, whenever I view that scene, I'm not like, why isn't Leia crying? Why isn't she breaking down? I always view it as like she does want to. She's very upset, obviously, but like she's such a strong character that she's literally trying to stay strong to like because of where she is and the position she's in, and she obviously doesn't want to give Tarkin or Vader any signs of weakness at all. So, and because of the way they do that in A New Hope, though, you never get. If she broke down in A New Hope, I feel like it would have added to like destruction of the Death Star and like how powerful it is and blah, 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 blah. But because she's our one good character in that scene, it then means that we as an audience never truly get the scale of emotion that we get through Rogue One and what it does for the Death Star.
It also happens like the Death Star blowing up Alderaan happens so early in the movie and in the franchise. Like you don't really get a weight of what the fuck just happened. Like you don't. It doesn't translate the humanity of it. And I think like this movie, I don't think I can ever say for any other Star Wars movie, except for maybe one moment in The Last Jedi, have I ever felt scared watching a Star Wars movie. Like, have I ever felt some kind of fear or trepidation about something? Where this movie really piques that in me several times throughout the viewing, where these moments of just despair and just pure everything's fucked. We're all fucked here. Like there's no, yeah, there's just so, it just isn't something that happens regularly in a Star Wars movie, which I find really refreshing in this one.
Yeah. The movie, like taking that one thing from like Nicole of New Hope, the entirety of Rogue One really is like building into you a sense of dread and realization of just how dire the situation was as you go into watching A New Hope. Like with that, I really do feel like this movie makes A New Hope better because it adds like all this emotional depth and knowledge that you kind of didn't have before, but you could only just assume. So next thing I wrote down was, it's actually a rather underappreciated part of the movie that Erso doesn't fall into the stereotype of the only one that can build the thing. So this is another thing I kind of just noticed this time. I was really appreciating watching it this time. Was that you may think that Galen Erso falls into that very shitty, like, scientist stereotype of the only one in the whole world that can somehow build the thing and no one else can do it for some reason. And it may seem like he's that at first, but he's actually not. And I do think that's important into, like, his whole story and the whole thing about him basically staying there and working and building in this trap and so on and so forth. Like, him talking about how he realized they didn't need him anymore, but he's able to play the part and make them think that they need him so he can then build in the trap. But I do think that a lot of people don't realize or never saw that, like, he isn't actually a very stereotypical character. Like, yes, he's smart. That's the whole thing. He is smart. He's like, obviously he was brought in because he was a smart scientist dude, but they never fall into the stereotype of making Galen one of the only people in the world that can do the thing because reasons, you know? So I kind of really appreciate that they're able to ride around these rather boring stereotypes. Next thing I wrote down was, the Mustafa scene. So good. That's all I have to say. Oh, and I'm glad they extended this castle in the comics in the Vaden VR game now. So I love this scene, obviously. It's really cool. I think looking back on it now, a couple of years since I've watched it, I find it interesting that, you know, because the first time you're watching Rogue One, you see the ship flying in, you're like, are we on? And because obviously they never put, that was the thing when it released, I remember, they never put the subtitle of the planet name. And that was always a thing that kind of annoyed me, because every other planet you go to throughout the movie, they always put up a piece of text telling you you're on Jeddah, you're on this planet, you're on whatever planet you are. And when they go to Mustafar. The hardest planet from Mustafar. The hardest planet for me to fucking say, apparently. When they
you're
go
a big
there,
Lion
they,
King fan.
Yeah, I am fucking, it's all Disney. When they go there, they never put up the title card. And I remember after the film released, everyone was like messaging. I could see all these people on Twitter like adding the Star Wars story group people and all these things being like, is it this, is it that? Because we all assumed where it was, but the movie never actually fucking confirmed. And everyone was like, we're 99% sure, but we just want that 1% confirmation, which we got later. But this was like day of release, of course. And the reason they didn't put the text up on the screen to tell you is because they wanted it to be more of a shocking moment when Vader's revealed, of course. And the other thing about this is Rogue One is the film that introduces the whole idea of Vader having this castle there, which they've continued to build upon after the fact through like the Vader comics that was talking about episodes ago, whatever one that was, Revenge of Sith or whatever. And how in that Darth Vader comic, they show how Vader goes there, why he builds his castle there. And it's basically because there's this giant Sith source power there that he's trying to drain energy from. The Vader VR game, which episode 2 is out now, and I haven't played it yet as of recording for this episode. But the whole thing about that Vader VR game is it's about Vader basically trying to find, once again, he's just obsessed with being able to bring Padme back to life. Like, he's trying to find a way through the abilities that that place can give him to bring Padme back to life. So it's not like random castle or whatever. But yeah, within the context of this movie, it is still just such a cool scene, flying in, Krennic there, Vader comes out. Well, the whole back to tank scene is cool, just to see him like, yes, he does get out of the suit and like try and attempt to heal up a little bit, because that's the whole thing with Vader, is like his body's just constantly in pain, you know? Like, so like the back to suit, the back to tank thing is like healing him is just kind of like a soothing salt bath, like I guess, to try and help keep the pain away somewhat. And then when he comes out of Krennic, and I remember, and I love it now, but I remember when it released and the whole Vader line of where he turns around, he's like, be careful not to choke on your aspirations, Director Krennic. I remember when the movie released, a lot of people would be like, oh, that's so corny for Vader to say. Fuck off. It is, I love it. Where he turns around, he's just got his hands out like in that like claw position because he's holding Krennic's throat. I love it. Yeah. How do you feel about this whole scene, this watch now?
I think it's one of those scenes that this movie didn't need to, and it still would have been a good movie. Like, you could take this part out and it would still be a good movie.
Yes.
But it adds so much to this, and there is a portion of this movie that I freaking rave about, because I raved about it last time we talked about this when we did the last season of Alderaan Explosion, where we watched this, where it explains so much about Darth Vader leading into A New Hope that it's really nice just to have these small touches of things that are happening to Vader and the things that he goes through, or like the normal stuff like using the tank. That is not something that's heavily featured a lot in the mainstream Star Wars movies. That is really nice just to have it there.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I mean, to a certain extent, it would be cool to have not had Vader in the entire movie until that last 5 minutes. Like, have no reference to him, and then he shows up and wreaks havoc in that last 5 minutes, but I guess. And then for the marketing to have been not include Darth Vader at all, that would have been fucking epic. But they decided, obviously, to go the other way and sort of build up to that moment at the end of the movie, so. I enjoyed it. It's cool. Mustafar looks cool.
Yeah, it's also just one of those things where it's like, maybe they wanted to introduce it here because they'd been kicking around these like comic ideas and, you know what I mean? Like, they, yeah. This is like an entry point to the whole Vader castle thing. Yeah. Which they're
I think they included it because they're like, hey, we want to put Darth Vader in this film. That will make sure that people
I definitely feel like that's the starting point, but then it's like, once they begin exploring and whatever else, it's like, well, if we introduce it here, then we can like kind of expand out here, maybe, you know, like everything needs a starting point. Yeah. Next thing I wrote down was all the Rebels references are my fave. Of course, last week we talked about Rebels, big fan of the show. Still, every time I watch this movie, I still just get excited. Like, even the first time they go to Yavin and you can spot the ghost ship, like up in the corner, I'm like, what's the ghost ship? And then like, the best one, I think, though, or you also see the ghost ship show up when the battle of Scarif is happening and all the ships are like popping out of hyperspace. But my favorite one is still just like towards the end of the movie when Jin's like walking away after she gave her whole big speech and they said, no, we can't go to battle of Scarif. You hear over the PA system, would General Harris and Dula please report to Redu? Would General Harris? I was like, oh, they're saying Hera's name in the movie. That's exciting. Shush. They released a Scarif map for the original Battlefront, and watching the fight kick off fills me with fond memories of it. So this was just a random thing. Like, it was the scene that made me write down this note is just the after they land in Scarif, and like Jin and all that are headed inside the building, and then they've got all the other guards or whatever, they're waiting outside that one like bunker entranceway or whatever. Yeah. And like that was a key point of the Battlefront map. And for whatever reason, this time I was watching the movie, I was just like, that was a fun map to play on. That was good. That was good time. Because it was a free release they did, like after Rogue One came out. They're like, here's a free map. And I played it quite a bit because I was like, this is a good map. And I enjoy playing on Scarif, and this is fun. Yeah. I played Battlefront 1 way more than Battlefront 2 is kind of what made me realize. Weirdly. But yeah.
How long do you think it took them to build that data center?
A year? I don't know.
That data center is fucking terrible. Like just the management of the whole...
But see, the thing about Star Wars tech is it's a long time ago, so it's quite old. They got space chips, but the tech is off.
Do you reckon there's like a generator at the bottom? Like that's why all the water's going into the...
Oh, I fucking don't know.
There'll be something keeping it cool.
Yeah. Maybe. Oh, that makes sense. Like the water goes in there and then it turns into steam and goes back up and then it goes... That's why the planet's not empty. It's still got water on it.
Next thing I wrote down was that they talk about hyperspace tracking here on Scarif before The Last Jedi uses it. There's your connection for people that think that technology just randomly shows up in the movie. So I think this is kind of much like how I was talking about last week with the whole like subtle thing of, you know, Rebels where they mention the whole cut off the ship, even if the windows breaks in the ship, like they show things in other things or like subtly mention them to like, and don't make a big deal about it, but then it's like for hardcore people who want to like find out why a technology or thing does happen, they are like subtly pointing it in. So basically when Jin's like searching through the files for the Death Star plans and like she's reading off all the things, one of the things she reads off is hyperspace tracking or whatever, which of course they use in The Last Jedi. That's how the First Order's chatting.
When they're chasing him, yeah.
When they're chasing him, and everyone was like, what the fuck, this technology just randomly comes out of nowhere, what the fuck? No, so by introducing it in this and having it in the project files here among all the other things that are like projects that are being worked on or explored or whatever, it's like the Empire at the time was exploring the technology, but they obviously just hadn't fully worked it out, and then you're obviously supposed to assume that the First Order manages to finish off the technology and figure out what needs to be done to make it work. But I definitely feel like it's one of those things where it's appreciated that they're able to sprinkle something like this in Rogue One, and then Last Jedi comes out and it's like... Last Jedi comes out and it's like people are getting so upset about it. It's like they don't need to explain it in that movie because it would be a complete waste of time. But for people who do want to like figure everything out, and you know what I mean? It's like, here's your answer. They were working on the technology. It didn't just come out of their ass. And of course, it's sort of retconning, but at the same time, Rogue One did come out before Last Jedi. You know what I mean? So there is like connective tissue across stuff and like people talking to one another. And of course, that's kind of what the story group's job, I guess, is, you know, to do these sorts of things. And,
and we also see hyperspace jumping ships ram into another. They ram into Lord Vader's ship at the end and sort of blow up, obviously, as a precursor, I guess. Like, they don't seem like they do much damage, but they're much smaller.
Yes.
But yeah. So it's not a crazy notion.
No. My next, talking about ramming. So yeah, so this movie, the next note I wrote down was, this movie has the most ham and out there space battle with all this tech in Rebels showing up like the hammerheads pushing a destroyer down. So yeah, that was another like.
I guess, I have a quick question to ask.
Yes.
Episode 3 or Rogue One space battle?
Rogue One.
Okay, good.
You're like, okay, good.
So we should see it above in the rankings. No, you were just gushing about Episode 3's space battle a few episodes
I don't think Episode 3 space battle is good. The thing I like about it that we see for a glimpse that I would like to see more of in hopefully Episode 9 is just you see so many ships around, like more than that's even in the battle here at Rogue One. Like you see like a depth of field like in a shot and you just see ships fucking everywhere. And my hope is that they take something like that we see in Revenge of the Sith, which is ships everywhere. And I just want to see that actually brought to life. Like show me a battle with that many ships. I don't think the space battle in Revenge of the Sith is very good. It's just, it gives me hints at a bigger battle that we hadn't actually seen before. There's no other movie that has that many ships as you see in that one frame. That's what I reckon. There's one frame where you see a ton of ships, and I think that's more ships than you see in any other movie. Do I think it's a better space battle? No.
Okay.
I just think it gives hints at something I want. So the hammerheads
ship is great. Yes.
The hammerheads are something that was introduced in Rebels, and that's another thing like connective tissue that I kind of appreciate. Once again, it's like they introduced these ships in Rebels prior to the third season, I think, of Rebels or something like that. And of course, second season, I think. And then like Rogue One comes out or whatever. And it's like, where did these ships come from? And of course, you know, general movie going fan probably doesn't even question where these ships come from or where they've been. But then it's like, for those that care, they were introduced in Rebels, and I kind of just do appreciate there is some like connective tissue as we're talking about here. The left hand does talk to the right hand between the different Star Wars projects somewhat, even if people don't think there's much communication stuff happening here. And I do think it's very cool. The idea of these ships being literally their job is to like fucking ram shit. like that's their whole destination. And then of course the last note I had down here was, the final 10 minutes never gets old, and it sure doesn't. Like that, I'd say the final 10 minutes to me is kind of like, well, maybe the final 15, I guess. Like from the moment Jin and Cassian kind of start climbing that tower, you know, the data tower, and that fantastic piece of music, which I love, which is like just the duh, duh. It kind of sounds like Jaws, I guess, if you try and do it like that. But it's just like,
yeah, the way you like, just said it.
Yeah,
it was just Jaws. It was
I was like, fuck, it is Jaws. As soon as I start doing that, it sounds like Jaws. But yeah, like, it's like this piece music kicks in right as they start doing that. That obviously starts building up the tension, and then they start killing off the characters left, right, here, there. Jin gets up top, does the thing that she needs to do. And then, yeah, it's like from the moment the Death Star shows up, and you're just like, oh. You know what's happening. Like, you know what's going the first time you're watching this. You know what's going to go down. And once again, kind of like just talking about Jedha, I think this final scene just has so much impact to it. Like, because with Jedha shows you the destruction and how fucked up and like really adds and makes the Death Star scary. And then it works so well because when the Death Star shows up here, you're like, oh shit. You know, like you're actually like scared of it. Because you know what's about to go down. And then when Jin and Cassian sit down on that beach and then they just get wiped to smithereens, and then that camera just kind of pans up from the planet there to Darth Vader arriving, then, yeah, that scene does not get old. I, like, literally still just sitting here watching him when he's... when all those the rebels are sitting there like trying to pass open that door, and then you just hear that fucking lightsaber light up and then Darth Vader appear out of the darkness. It's like... oh, so good. I really wish I never wanted a Darth Vader solo movie until that scene. And then all of a sudden I was like, yes, I would like a Darth Vader solo movie if only it's a horror movie and he's the villain and he's not the main character. Like, I want it to be about Jason, other people. Yeah, I want him to be Jason in a Vader movie, basically, and just make it like
tell you what
end scene here.
Star Wars Publishing, we want an asymmetrical Darth Vader game.
I mean, yeah, it'd be really fun, yeah. So does anyone
have
any...
closer, he just plays his theme.
Yeah, Jaws theme. Da-da. Anyone have any final thoughts on this movie or the last scene or anything?
This movie explains so much in New Hope that it's weird to think that there was a time where we watched New Hope without having the knowledge of this movie. Like, I think this movie makes New Hope a better movie.
I think it does, yeah.
Like, yeah. It just does so much to make... Like, just the... I'll talk about it more next week, but just, like, having the questions filled in about why Darth Vader is so pissed off when he enters the ship on at the start of the movie is just... It's so understandable and so good that... Yeah, it just makes that scene even better when we watch it next week.
Ash, any final?
Yeah, this is great. I really love it. How do you guys feel about Tarkin this time watching it through? Is it distracting anymore?
I think I'm just used to it.
I'm used to it now.
Care or think about it.
Same with Leia at the end. What was that feel?
Leia's worse for me. I think Leia was worse than Tarkin was. And I don't know why. Like, maybe it's because of the lighting and the environment that Leia's in just makes it look really weird.
I will say, though, for everyone complaining about this technology that they used in this movie, if they didn't use it in this movie or at least try, and, like, if they took the criticism that they shouldn't be trying to do this sort of stuff, a lot of stuff that's happened over in Marvel movies over the last couple of years wouldn't have happened.
Yeah,
you know, because it's the same technology that they just keep working on and getting better at year after year after year, and it's the same group of people. So it's like if they took everyone's criticism from this, and be like, no, you shouldn't do it. It looks horrible. You know, then it's like you wouldn't have had the Robert Downey Jr. and fucking whoever else.
We wouldn't have Samuel L. Jackson acting the entire movie where he's like 30 years younger. Like,
And you're probably like, oh, it's a bit different because they're literally different. Like actors being brought to life. It's the same technology though, just being used in different ways though. So it's like they could make it Rogue One today, if they made it this year, that both Tarkin and Leia would look better because they just keep getting better and better and better at using that sort of technology. So yeah, it's fine. You know, it's only a couple of years old, but the technology grows so fast these days, I think. All right. So to the big question, Ash,
this is the best one so far.
Okay, I was about to say, I'll just quickly read off everyone's list because I feel like I should.
Okay.
So I currently have at number 10 in my rankings, episode 2, I have Solo, episode 1, episode 3. Ash currently has episode 2, episode 1, episode 3, Solo. Kieran has episode 2, episode 1, Solo, and then episode 3. So what you're telling me, Ash, is that you want to put this at... the highest position, which would be position 6 so far.
Yep.
You want to put Rogue One?
Yes.
Okay.
Rogue.
Rogue.
One.
Oh, yeah. That's less corny than the Solo thing, by the way.
Solo.
You know? How do you feel about that one? You know how, like, what are
that
we?
One We're felt more Rogue natural.
One.
Than...
That one felt way more natural.
It didn't feel more natural.
Way more natural.
Yeah, it feels way more natural. Yes, it did.
Feels way more natural than the Han Solo one.
No, it was just too much of a pause.
Rogue One? No, I like it. I think it's fine.
I'm fine with it.
Kieran, where are you ranking this one?
Yeah, chuck it in that number 6 spot for me, please.
Just chuck it in that number 6.
Just chucking it up there at number 6 at the tippity top. Thanks.
Chuck it in at the top there, would you please, sir? Now, I'm probably going to move it.
I don't know if we're going to the point where Dylan's like, I'm just gonna start moving shit around to be a dick.
No, I am with yous this week. I am also putting this one at number 6.
This is probably one of the ones that I'd revolt about if you put below the ones we've watched so far. I would revolt.
So that makes our rankings somewhat not very exciting this week, but, you know, at least Solo shook things up a little bit yeah. different a couple weeks ago. And I do think it'll be interesting. I'm just looking at it, you know, I'm looking at the list and I'm like, all right, we'll see how we go.
I think we're getting into the interesting part in the next 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Like the next six will be interesting.
Yeah. All right. So next week's episode of Old Rang Explosion, we will be watching Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope. So make sure you watch that movie before then. Please share this episode on social media and tag at Explosion Pod if you're enjoying it. Tell your friends and rate on Apple Podcasts or Podchaser. Old Rang Explosion is a Darth production of ExplosionNetwork.com, which is where you also find What Do You Want to Watch, our fortnightly movie and TV podcast. You can follow me on Twitter at VivaLadil, VivaLadil. You can follow Ash on Twitter at Ashley Hobley, AshleyHobley. And you can follow Ciaran on Twitter at YupBoyRingo. Until next week, may the force be with you always.